Hi everyone, thank you very much for being here with me today for episode 9 of the Software Architecture Fundamental Stream. Today we continue our discussion on transactions, both the transactions at one service side, but also distributed transactions, which was the subject we discussed in the previous episode. We discussed about the SAGA pattern, and you have seen we have different ways to implement mechanisms that help us keeping the data consistent when we have multiple services, each one with its own persistence layer. That's something that it's very common, very usual happens in microservices architectures. And we ended our last time discussion with how do we keep our data consistent when we have multiple transactions that act at the same time on the same set of data. And of course, this is not only a problem with distributed systems and service-oriented architectures. This is actually a problem that might occur also when you have only one service. So if you only refer to one service or maybe a monolithic application, you still have the situation where multiple transactions can be executed on the same set of data at the same time. And then this is why we discussed today about one of the four characteristics of these transactions that is called isolation. And for those of you who might be already aware of transactions or maybe have seen the previous episode, you know that we say that transactions are ACID, which actually means atomic, consistent, isolated, and durable. And in this case, we are basically focused on the I, in this case, being the isolation, the characteristic of the transaction that tells us what happened depending on how we configure our transaction and how we actually have the transaction. What happens if you have two or more transactions at the same time working on the same set of data? And I have already told you a few things about the anomalies or inconsistencies that can occur when you have such situations in applications. In the previous episode, you may remember we have discussed about dirty reads, repeatable reads, and phantom reads. I will tell you again, taking each of these by example, so that you understand what these anomalies are and how can they occur. Then we discuss how can they be solved when you have only one service, and you can manage the isolation directly by the service itself. For example, frameworks such as Spring allow you to do that out of the box. For example, with Spring, you have the transactional annotation. On the transactional annotation, you can specify the transaction isolation level. And then at the application level, the threads are managed such in a way in which you don't have to worry about, for example, the transactions being at the same time just because you made them serializable. Or you might make them read committed, read uncommitted, repeatable read, because these are the four layers of isolation you find in applications. Or you might at some point decide to set these isolation layers at the database level. That is a little bit easier when it comes to only one application and only one DBMS, because in this case, of course, you have this possibility of managing either the threads at the application level or setting isolation level at the database management system level. But of course, you have a little bit a bigger problem when it comes to multiple services, because then you have multiple database management systems and of course multiple applications. So simply synchronizing threads or setting the isolation level at the DBM, the isolation level at the DBMS side is not a solution anymore. And that's why, now if I remember, at some point I read a book that I also recommended you in the previous episodes, the Microservices Patterns from Chris Richardson. He says that in case of service-oriented architecture, we say that it's only ACD, so it's not an ACID anymore. The I is missing because there is no way of discussing about isolation in case of having a distributed persistent layer, as it happens in the case of microservices. But of course, to understand them well, we start from what the isolation is, and then by comparing with what we discussed in the previous episode, we refer to service-oriented architectures, and we see what solutions we have for both cases. So which are the solutions for the different consistency problems, anomalies in data that may occur when you have only one service and isolation of the transaction, and also what happens when you say have a SAGA pattern implementation and there is no such isolation anymore. So how can you use locking, because that's basically what I will teach you to use in such a case. How can you use locking to still avoid anomalies? And of course, because as in any other architectural situation, you have multiple choices. We will discuss, I won't say all of them, because I have the impression that are even much, I already know there are more than these two that I will present you. And I think there might be even more than I know. But the idea is that I will present you those that I think they are most often encountered or most useful for real world scenarios. So I prefer to focus on those that I think you will rather use more often than trying to make this an episode or a stream where we discuss all the details, and some details you might not find used, or they might be only theoretical. I will also tell you what to avoid, of course, in such cases. So let me represent again the transactions using two time arrows. You know that I prefer to represent my transaction with time arrow, because you simply have multiple operations that happen in a specific order on a transaction, so you can represent them like this, and it's a pretty common approach to represent them with a time arrow. And say we have three anomalies that can occur, and I want to point them here just to be able to refer to them anytime. So we say the dirty reads, we have the repeatable reads, and we have the phantom reads. And let me make this a little bit smaller for the beginning. And in case you have only one service, the solution for this are using one of the four isolation levels. And these isolation levels, they are the read uncommitted, read committed, repeatable read, and serializable. You will also find them explained in my Spring Fundamentals playlist on this channel if you want to know how they work with Spring, because and how to apply them with Spring, because I know some of you are eager to also see something more in action than the theory I have reserved for this stream. So I tell you from the very beginning that you can already find the video where I explain, for example, how to use this with Spring. But now I would like to refer to a little bit from a little bit more general point of view, because this is not something that is only Spring related. This is something that is more at an architectural level, so we can apply it agnostic of the technologies. And that's why let's now focus on them of what they are, and not necessarily refer to a specific technology, because as I've told you from the very beginning, even if I most likely will give you examples from the Java ecosystem, because I'm a Java developer, so that's my background knowledge, What I present you here, most of the things, 99% of them, which refer to architecture and design, they apply similarly no matter of the technology, language or the platform you use. So that's the same case with the transaction isolation and the patterns for the distributed transactions and everything else that we will discuss. So you see, the dirty reads and all the others, basically all of these anomalies, they can occur if you are on a read uncommitted isolation level. And the read uncommitted isolation level is basically the equivalent with what happens when you have distributed transactions. So if you use a distributed transaction or a saga pattern and you have multiple services, you can consider you are at this isolation level. There's basically isolation doesn't exist in that case. That's why, as I've said, some authors even take the I out of ACID when discussing about distributed systems. But you can either think like that, or the analogy is you are to the read uncommitted when we discuss about distributed transactions. So all the other three, when we discuss about read committed, repeatable, read and serializable, theoretically they only apply when you refer to transactions at only one service. When you go to multiple services, to a service-oriented architecture or microservice architecture, then either you think that the isolation is completely missing, which is basically equivalent to what we call the read uncommitted layer here. So this way I try to make you also some a parallel between these overviews. Probably for some of you it makes the concepts easier to understand. When you have a read uncommitted, or the equivalent of no isolation, it means that any transaction represented with an arrow here in my case can read what is changed in parallel by other transactions that even didn't commit the changes. So even if the changes have not been committed yet, a transaction can read what the other transaction does. So say you have a change, again, my example from the previous episodes, if I correctly remember, was with the book inventory that was decreasing when you buy a book. So the inventory, if the inventory shows a 10 at the very beginning, that means you have 10 books. And then what you do is, sorry for that. So then what you do is decreasing the inventory with 1, because this transaction, say, refers to what happens when a user buys a book. Then of course you expect that the inventory number will go to a 9 here. So that's a simple operation of update, isn't it? So we discussed now in general about any kind of mutation operation. I took as an example the simplest I could think about, an update in my case. To visualize it, you have an inventory of books, you have 10 books, somebody buys a book, now you have 9 books. So what happens now is that if this is the transaction and now you have one transaction in parallel and you use the read uncommitted, then this transaction here, the second arrow representing the transaction, which you can, if you want to have some names for them to make it easier to refer to them, let's call them T1 and T2. If it reads now the inventory of the same book, it will read a 9. And maybe you will think about why is it actually reading a 9 if the first transaction didn't commit already. Well, this is because, and this is why we call it read uncommitted, because in this isolation level where we call it read uncommitted, we simply assume that a transaction can read something that was not committed already by another transaction. And of course, the real world scenario is a little bit more complex, because now we refer from the theoretical perspective to only 2 transactions, but imagine that you might have even a million of transactions at the same time. It's the number, we don't have a limit for the number of transactions, at least not theoretically. Of course, physically you always have limitations, but here, from the theoretical point of view, you might have more than two. So things might become even more complex. And in web applications, for example, which is the case of most of the applications today, you might have, in a standard web application, you might have you have actually a thread for each request, for each HTTP request. So if you have two people simultaneously trying to buy the book, then you will get exactly into this situation. And as I've told you, always the compromise is, how much does it bother me? Is it something that I can live with? Is this data inconsistency something that I can have in my application? Because sometimes it is, then you can go with it. And the idea is the following. When you see these isolation levels, the way I put them here, from top to bottom, from read uncommitted to serializable, they are precisely in the order of isolation. So that means that read uncommitted is the least isolated, and again, equivalent with no isolation. That's why I said at the very beginning, you can make an analogy from what read uncommitted is to how a distributed transaction works when you have multiple services. So you you have the complete lack of isolation in this case. Then you have one step further read committed, which means that, as you will see, a transaction might only see what another transaction committed. Then you have repeatable reads, which I will tell you that it might happen when you have still two transactions at the same time, two or more transactions at the same time, that a same transaction might read different data. And then phantom reads, which can only be mitigated if you use the serializable, which serializable means you don't have actually transactions at the same time on the same set of data. So there is only one transaction at a time working with the set of data. Serializable means that they are put one after the other. So suddenly you cannot have parallelism of the transactions on the same set of data. So how now, going back to the read uncommitted, the equivalent with no isolation, what it happens again is that, being that we use read uncommitted, even though T1 didn't commit, you will be able to see, T2 will be able to see the change, which is, it might read a 9. And the problem here is, what happens if T1 encounters a problem and it rolls back, because you know that a transaction, the A in the ACID, it comes from atomicity, which is, it allows, if any problem occurs, the transaction can roll back, and that means that any change done by a mutation operation will be disconsidered, and the data will be rolled back to the way it looked like when the transaction began. So that might happen in this case as well. So imagine T1 encountered an exception, then all the operations, all the mutations that have been done since the start of the transaction will be rolled back, so that the 9 will become a 10 again. So that's dirty read, because T2 now doesn't know that. So T2 already read a 9. So now it uses a 9, considering that the 9 is the real value, even though T1 roll back the value to 10, and that is called a dirty read. And that is something that can happen also when you have distributed transactions and where you don't have isolation at all. And the way to mitigate this, if you are only at one service side, a way to mitigate it is just increase the isolation level, which is go at least one step further, one step below in my enumeration here, to the read committed. Because if you go to the read committed, then suddenly you have solved this problem. You might wonder, why do we have all these levels? So why don't we only have the serializable and that's it? Because anyway, do you want to have inconsistencies in the data? So does it happen that you actually don't you actually prefer to have data as much consistent as possible? That doesn't matter the case. And the answer is yes, that would be perfect. In a perfect world and with perfect applications, we would have always only consistencies. The problem with keeping the data consistent is that like in almost any other architectural choice, a compromise. The compromise between performance and having the data consistent. So the more you go into covering the isolation and keeping your data consistent, the less performant your application will be. So that's why we are not discussing about how to make the data perfectly consistent. We are discussing about how to choose from having consistent data versus having an application that is more performant. So, Laurentiu, is this reachable in practice, or is covered database solution vendors DB, or is covered by database solution vendors DB servers? If we discuss about isolation levels, yes, it is in practice. It is not only at the database vendors, it is also sometimes something that you solve at the application level. For example, I was saying that in case of Spring, you might decide which is the isolation level from the framework itself, which Spring, small parenthesis here, it implements through its platform transaction manager, the way it's called in Spring, it implements a two-phase commit at the service layer, and by that mechanism of the two-phase commit, it allows you to manage the isolation with precisely these four. So is this something real world? Yes, it is very real world. Is it something that only the database management system handles? No, it is something that might be handled by the database management system, but can be as well handled by the application. And is it something that the application might avoid to handle? Sometimes yes, if you discuss only one service, then you might already put all the weight on the shoulders of the database management system. But when you have multiple services, then you have no choice, because now if you have the persistent layer splitted, as we discussed in the previous episode, and you have multiple database management system instances, then you can't use the isolation anymore only at the database management system level. So you already have to think about these isolation levels and the anomalies that can occur. So is there a scenario considering code to reach this read uncommitted scenario? I ask because default level is the next one. Precisely, the read committed is the default one. So the others, which is the read uncommitted, I started with because I also want to compare it with what happens when you have multiple services. So now if we think at the one service level, so only have one service, by default, we use the read committed, and usually defaults, when we will find defaults that have been configured, it's either because that's the most used scenario, and maybe that's the most probable case. When somebody puts a default, is because you want to bother with changing that only in very, very little situations, a very little number of situations. And that's why the read committed is the default, because usually it's the best compromise. It's usually the best compromise between performance, the performance you gain, and the data consistency. However, there are still cases in which you use read uncommitted even if you have only one service, because using the read uncommitted, it allows us, by making some compromise with the data consistency, to improve a lot our data, our performance, the performance of the application. So of course, my example is most likely not the best one, and it's probably difficult to find a good example for the read uncommitted. Because in most cases, as I was saying, data consistency seems to be very relevant, and it is. But there are cases where you don't care about data consistency. For example, in some application, and maybe in most of the applications, logs like when you log something, an error message or an information message, are not that much relevant, which means that if you have a situation where the same log message is logged twice, And sometimes, even if it's not logged at all, if it's an info message and not an error message, you might not care that much. So let's think about this situation. Is this a use case where we might think of using something like read uncommitted instead of using the read committed? Well, yes, because if you don't care about the data consistency, because if you don't care that a specific info message of your log is not there, then you will prefer to improve the performance of your application by making the compromise with the data consistency, just because in this case the data consistency is not that relevant. So that's a case, of course. It's a compromise, it's just a compromise between performance and consistency where it gets. So reading uncommitted transactions can help in debugging problems. Yes, we could say that either, even if I don't think I ever used in debugging, I never think I've used this, like making a transaction uncommitted just to be able to see from outside that that it wrote something. But I can't say this could not be a great idea. And by the way, guys, I didn't tell you, maybe it's a good, with this occasion, it's a good time to tell you that I will actually be writing a book on debugging. So Tudor, I think I will take this as a note and I might refer to it from my book. And thank you for that. It might be a very good idea to just change the isolation to read uncommitted, because then you can see what a transaction did without allowing it to commit. So that can be an idea. Cool. But mainly when we discuss about implementing applications and not necessarily debugging, it's just a compromise between consistency and performance. And that's what happens. Of course, this dirty read will not occur anymore in case you have a read committed, because now say you have changed it to the read committed, then what happens is that if T1 changes this to 9, T2 now still can't see the 9, because here it wasn't yet committed. So if T2 reads the value of the inventory in my book example here, it will read a 10 and not a 9, because T2 in the read committed, which is again, as you said, also the default, is only able to read something that has been committed. Now, why is read committed still causing problems? Well, read committed doesn't solve all your problems. Otherwise, the repeatable read and the serializable levels would not have existed. Repeatable reads is another data inconsistency that can happen even if you have a read committed isolation level. And that is still. So now you will say, okay, say I committed the change here and T2 can only read after I committed. Fine, what other problems could that cause? Because now it won't be a 9, it will be a 10, and it will be, of course, the correct value because it's already committed, so the first transaction can't roll back anymore. But that still doesn't mean that another transaction cannot change the value again. So in that case, if another transaction now, a T3, would change the value to 11, but T2 didn't yet end it, and it reads again the same value, now the problem is that T2 would be able to read multiple different values for the same information. So suddenly for T2, when it first reads, it will be a 10, because that was what T1 committed, and because another transaction T3 at the same time ended and changed the transaction to 11, now T2 that didn't end and didn't commit yet will read again the same value from the database, but it will read 11, and that's a problem because it creates again an inconsistency. Where is the inconsistency? Of course, from the fact that now T2 read the same data in the database with two different values. Which is the correct one? Is it 10, the first one that T2 read for that, or is it 11, the one that was secondly read? And of course, you have, again, different ways to mitigate it. A first way is avoid to read repeatedly the same value. So in that case, just as if you read the inventory once, assume that throughout the whole transaction, assume that is the correct value, which can create some problems as well if you have, again, multiple transactions at the same time, because if the third one changes to 11 and you then put a 10 instead, then you will override what that transaction did. So that might create, again, other inconsistencies. Or you, of course, and the best probably choice if you really care of this consistency, you go to the next level, the repeatable read. And guess what the repeatable read does? It's actually blocking the rows such that a third transaction now will not be able to change that until T2 will end and will commit and will liberate, will free that lock. So that will solve the repeatable reads, but with what a cost? The cost of performance. Because now suddenly you cannot have two transactions that work on the same row and update the same attribute of a record at the same time. So the transactions now that do that, if you will have that, they will have to wait out one after the other, which means that the times now of executing two use cases might add up, or at least the two transactions times will add up. And that means, of course, longer time, probably to go into performance problems. So that's why you have to really think very well about when you go to and expect more consistency, because consistency is good, but it's not all the times needed. And if you apply powerful isolation level to keep the consistency where it's not needed, you will do nothing for helping your application. You will just basically decrease its performance. So you really have to think about when you increase an isolation level, you really have to think about, is it really needed? Because if it's not needed, then you better not do that. You better live with the inconsistencies in that case, and prefer having an app that's more performant, because performance is one of the most easy to observe software qualities, non-functional software qualities for a user. Think about it. You are using applications, isn't it? Have you ever used an application on your mobile app or on your desktop and it stuck, or it worked slower? Did you observe that? Of course you observe that. So there are kinds of software qualities that are easier to observe, kinds of non-functional software qualities that are less easier to observe. For example, security, unfortunately, it's one of the least easier to observe software qualities. It's difficult to see if an application is not secure. While the performance for a user, you don't need to have special studies to find to observe that some kind of application doesn't work, is not solving your task in the expected time. So you indirectly impact the users by decreasing the performance. So it's something that it will be the easiest thing to observe for the users if you don't take care of the performance. And that's why this is really important from an architectural point of view. Cool. Now, still, I want to also discuss about serializable, which is solving the repeatable reads as well. So it's solving this problem where now T2 might read a value and then read a different value because some other transaction committed a different value. So we have two different values. To solve it, you go to the repeatable read. The repeatable read level, as we discussed, it blocks the record. So if it blocks the record, some third transaction now has to wait for the second in case that specific row was accessed. So you cannot have repeatable reads anymore. But there is still the phantom reads case. And the phantom reads case is what happens when you have multiple records. So imagine this. Instead of inventories, you read the books, the book records. So you have book details, records in a table, and you read 10 of them here, and then one of them is deleted. These phantom reads usually occur when you either delete or add rows to a table. Say you delete one of the rows, now you have 9, and what happens is that, of course, you will be able to read the 9 records, and then if a third transaction comes and change them to an 8, you will be able to read the 8, and that's again, you read here 9 rows, and then you will read 8. And here is not reading one value. Again, when previously my 9, the 9 and the 8 and the 10 was a value on a field, but now it's a number of records. So the rows you select, 10 rows, you delete a row, you have 9 rows. T2 will read 9 rows because T1 committed. And then because a separate transaction at the same time deletes one more record, it will read 8 records. And that one record missing from the 9 and the 8, so the record that is now missing, it's called a phantom record. So it's a phantom read. It disappeared like a phantom. You don't know where it is. And the same thing is when you add. If we were the other way around, we had 9 and we were adding a record, and now you have 9 and then you will have 10 here because one record has been inserted in the table. And you read 9 records, but now at the second time on the same transaction you read 10, a row in the tables or a record appeared from nowhere, like a phantom. And that's why you call it a phantom read. So that's a phantom read. And that's something you can only solve with a serializable level of the transaction, which implies that all the rows are blocked. So suddenly the transactions actually cannot work at the same time anymore. If they do write operations, they will always be one after the other. And of course, as you can probably imagine, this affects dramatically the performance. So that's why you will very rarely see something like that used. And I would actually not recommend it at all. And instead of using that, I would prefer to go to a locking approach. And that's how I want to start now discussing what optimistic and pessimistic locking is. So we have these solutions we discussed. We have these problems that I hope they are clear now. I won't just repeat them again because they are the same that can appear with distributed transactions. And when I say distributed transactions, I refer to either the saga pattern or the two-phase commit that we discussed in the previous episode. The idea is that the same inconsistencies in the data might occur when you have multiple services and a use case that concerns changing data in multiple persistence layer managed by multiple services in a microservices architecture. But the only problem is that there you don't have the read committed or the repeatable read or the serializable anymore, because there is basically a saga pattern. It doesn't imply one transaction, even if you might think of it of one transaction. It is actually a sum of transactions, of independent transactions at a different working, applying the changes at different persistent layers at different services. So because of that, the distributed transactions don't have an isolation. So that's why for the distributed transaction for multiple services, the I is missing. And we say it's only ACD. It's not an ACID, it's only ACD because it doesn't have isolation. Or as I said at the beginning of our episode, you can imagine that it's equivalent to what we consider to be read uncommitted when we discuss about only one service. How do we solve that? Well, we have the possibility to use locking. And we have two kinds of locking that you might use, the optimistic approach and the pessimistic approach. And this is something that you can use also when you have only one service. So the locking is an alternative you can use to the isolation levels for only one service, but is somehow the only solution you can use when you have multiple services, because when you have multiple services, isolation levels again is no longer a solution. So you would go to a locking approach that would be either optimistic or pessimistic, and I will now explain these optimistic and pessimistic locking, what they are and how can you apply them and which is the best to use in depending the situation. So let me just write them here. And can start with either one of them. I don't think it's really important which one I take first, but let's take first the optimistic, just because I put them in this order here, which is also my favorite. Actually, I don't say that you will not use pessimistic locking, but I do always prefer to give a chance to optimistic locking before thinking about the pessimistic locking, and not only because I'm an optimist and not a pessimist, but because it gives more chances to performance. And you will understand why when I will explain what optimistic locking is. The optimistic locking is not actually blocking something. The optimistic locking allows the transactions to just go at the same time as they happen. But when one transaction changes something, it marks somehow that it did that change. Usually, we use a version number. So you have a record like the book inventory. Say you have the book inventory again, my today's example and my last episode's example. And you have a transaction changing book one, whatever that is, from inventory 10 to inventory 9. What it does, it marks the changes by also incrementing another value that we call the version. So instead of having only the record itself has also a version number. So when something changes, whatever the change is, the version increments. So if the version has been 1, it will be, say, incremented, changed to a 2. There are multiple approaches for the version. Incrementing a number is maybe the easiest. There is also a possibility of using unique identifiers for the version. Both have advantages and disadvantages. Let me avoid referring to disadvantages and disadvantages now because they are not really relevant for the explanation of the optimistic and pessimistic locking. Just imagine you chose to, in that case, in my case here, use numbers and increment numbers. So the version, the transaction changed the inventory for book one from 10 to 9, as it was in my case here, my previous example, and now the version of this incremented to 2. So what happens is that, we have to see if something changed in between when you have a separate transaction working with that. The separate transaction, you might see if this was actually changed somehow. So you use this field to see that something is in progress. So you have like this is like a status where the transaction currently working on this record states, I'm in progress with changes on this field. And then if it happens that a separate transaction needs to change the same record, it uses this value to observe that the change is in progress. And by observing the changes in progress, it stops, it quits working on that anymore. And usually in that case, we have again multiple approaches in which you can treat that. You can simply throw an exception. If you don't want to continue and you want the user, for example, to retry doing something, or you might want to simply somehow queue the transaction after this other one, which implies a more complicated implementation, you can, that's maybe the the most often situations that you will encounter. So you either quit completely or you queue the operation after the other one, so it just wait for the lock to be released and then continues. But the idea is thank you very much for your appreciations. So the idea is that in case of the optimistic locking, why is that more performant? Because I started with telling you that I prefer the optimistic locking because it helps us make our application more performant. And the idea is that if you don't just block the record because you are using it and assume that you assume that nobody will change it further, so that's why it's called optimistic. You are an optimist. You assume nobody else will change it. You just change it and say, okay, I mark that I changed that, but I don't block it. The record can stay as is, and I assume nobody else will change it. Then in this case, the idea is that you don't have to apply any lock on your records. You just leave it as is. If you have other transactions that are reading the value, then you might decide if you want to allow the read or not. But the idea is that you simply assume from the very beginning the table might completely remain unlocked. And if something happens, like if a change occurred, if another transaction tries to change that value or read the value that was changed, then you simply only in that case take action. So you see, when you apply an optimistic approach, you might get rarely into the, or at least more rare than if you all the time block the table, get into the case where you have to act upon the change. With an optimistic lock, you act on the change only if it happens. You don't have to act if no other transaction will work on that data. While with a pessimistic approach, that's always from the very beginning. When you change that, you just block the record, and it doesn't matter if somebody tries or not to change it anymore. It will always be blocked. So that costs basically a little bit more from the performance of your application, because you act upon blocking a record, even though it might even not happen that somebody would try to change it. And so question. I have a lot of pessimistic lock exceptions in my application logs that I'm working. It's not my code that I wrote, so it needs a refactor. Yeah, so I don't really like pessimistic locking, but theoretically what happens is that it's a little bit more easier to manage. So usually people who use pessimistic locking, I've seen a lot of cases, I don't say that's always the case, but I've seen a lot of cases where pessimistic locking has been used just because it's so easy. I mean, it's just make it by a configuration anytime some record is changed and the transaction didn't end, you block it and that's it. So that's easier because you don't have to manage any version on the record. It's a little bit less logic to write. If you have a short time of implementation and or you don't care, then pessimistic locking might simply be an easier approach than trying to implement the locking in an optimistic way. However, the pessimistic locking simply implies that you will always serialize transactions, and that's something that you will observe over time, that it affects the performance of the application, where again sometimes you can spare that, so you can just spare that. I've read once referring as logical locking, optimistic locking, and physical locking, pessimistic locking. Yes, I think I've seen that as well, this terminology, even though, and somebody actually asked me at some point, Am I a fan of using multiple terminologies? I'm not really a fan of referring to the same thing in multiple ways, simply because I don't trust human language. So you will observe with time that human language is very, it doesn't matter if it's English, Romanian or something else, it's usually, it creates a lot of confusions. Like, for example, somebody asked me some days ago about the difference between the same responsibility and concern. What is the difference between having saying we have one concern or we have a single responsibility? Is this the same thing? And it simply turns out that it's actually the same thing, but it's just you just use different terminology for it. So that's why I prefer to stick on only one approach of referring to this, because human language might be tricky if you use different ways to refer to the same thing. But I think I found that terminology as well being used now and then. So yes, I think you might find the logical locking being equivalent with what we call optimistic locking and physical locking to what it is a pessimistic locking. But yeah, again, so my conclusion is on that. You need to know that you have both approaches, but take them into consideration, and my advice would be always consider optimistic first and pessimistic last, because the optimistic locking approach, if that's a case where you can apply it, it might save some say some performance of your applications. What other approaches did I find? One of the approaches I found is the repeatable read approach. So it's also some kind of an optimistic approach, but I don't really agree with it. And at least you have to be very careful with it. It's the idea of not having either optimistic or pessimistic locking. Like, you don't have a version on the record. You just repeat the read when you want to make sure that the value stayed the same. So imagine the following idea: something changes this to 9 and your transaction reads it as a 9, and then you just read this again as an 8 here. So you repeat the read in this case just to make sure if something changed, and then reuse either the 8 through the hole, or simply throw an exception, like in the case of the optimistic locking. So instead of having some specific version, you use the value itself, because the value itself gives you the opportunity of, instead of throwing an exception, just reusing the value and retaking the full use case, which might work if you have a short use case and it doesn't take a lot of time. It's, in this case, similar to what a retry is, because we discussed about retrying operations in one of the previous episodes. But in case you do that again and again, and you don't apply a limitation for that, how many times can you do that? You will, of course, face a situation where the operation will going to enter a starvation case, where it simply cannot end. It's always continuously finds out that something was changed, and it takes too much that it's in a starvation mode, because it can't finish. Or it simply will take too much if your operation from the very beginning takes a lot of time. Just repeating it might not be a solution, because if this is something that was called by a front-end application, then somebody pressing a specific button or a search field or something like that, using a search field and staying there seeing how the application locked in its browser, won't be happy to see that. So you see, it's not something I can detail in all its possible ways, just because I can say that I read so many things, so many ideas in papers and books, and I've seen so many implementations, that I find the way developers treated this to be so diverse I won't even be able to remember probably all the things that I've ever read or seen in this how to keep the consistency when you have a distributed transaction. But the idea is that in most cases, as I've said also at the beginning of the episode, and that was my purpose, I think this is the at least foundation you need to have to know which are your basic options and where you can start from of thinking of even more custom solutions for your implementations. Because again, software architecture and software development in general is difficult, not because you have a cookbook that gives you all the possible recipes, but because you don't have any, and that's not possible to have any. And you always have some best practices, but even the best practices might become anti-patterns if you don't know how to use them. So at least say, I consider this to be the foundation that helped me take decisions in some cases where I had to take decisions on how to implement this consistency. And based on the system, I had to implement the specific mechanisms. Of course, I took a decision or the other, or an approach or the other, depending on what the application was and how it worked. What will be the case of pessimistic locking usage? So probably in case you know that you have a lot of chances that in case of optimistic versus pessimistic locking, you actually go on probabilities, isn't it? When you choose a pessimistic locking, you choose a when you choose an optimistic locking, you choose an optimistic locking because you might think about a specific use case that use those records, and you say there is a very low chance. So it's a probabilistic, okay? It's a very low chance that two transactions will at the same time change the same data, because you know, for example, you know that there are maybe two users that are changing that specific kind of record, and one is doing that from Asia and the other one is doing that from the US. So in that case, it's almost zero the case where you have to where that will happen. Of course, you still have to take care of the inconsistency. So you implement an optimistic locking approach because the chance of having the record changed at the same time, it is almost zero. And if that happens, then if one of the users fails, it gives an error and it will retry and it will work again. But when you have a situation where you know that the chances of having that being at the same time changed by more, then by more transactions, by maybe more users or whatever the generates those transactions, then you maybe want to use a pessimistic locking. So you don't want to even allow someone to change a specific record since they don't have it. Let me give you another example where optimistic locking is now used in real world scenarios, something that you have, it's very possible that you have seen. So do you buy airplane tickets? So maybe you bought some ticket for your vacation destination, and maybe it happened to you that you simply bought a ticket, say just filled all the steps, and you just got at the very end of the process of buying the ticket, and then you was just when you pressed pay, it just gives you back there are no longer any more tickets for this plane, for this flight. And then you say, how is that possible? How is that even possible? So I just started buying my ticket for this flight. It seems that everything went well, and when I press the pay button at the very end step, isn't that frustrating? But maybe it happened to you. I think it happened to me more than once. And the reason for why that is implemented like this, maybe you asked, okay, why did they implement it like this? Because it's frustrating for the users, isn't it? But if you think the other way around, if you were actually blocking from the beginning somehow the place by trying to buy, if they were applying a pessimistic approach, then they would have to, when you just started the process, they would have blocked that place. And then nobody at the same time could have accessed that. And then at some point, you get at the very end, and it takes 15 minutes to get at the very end, because you know you have to insert the passport details and so on. And you say, oh my God, I don't have enough money. So what should I do? Let me cancel now the process, and maybe I come back tomorrow and buy it again, because I know the salary day is tomorrow, and I will have more money, and now I don't have enough money. If that was the case, then the airline might have lost someone else who would have actually bought that at the same time with you, and for that person, the optimistic locking is actually better, because it allows more just at the same time buy the ticket, but at the very end it rejects those that were not able to buy it, and it only allows the one that actually manages to pay first for it. And that's an optimistic approach, and you from the perspective of the company, it's a very good choice. For the perspective of the user, of course, it might not be, because it's frustrating, but it allows the company sell faster, and selling faster is better, at least for any company. Making money faster is better than making money slower. You might decide to on an optimistic versus a pessimistic locking approach, not necessarily only because of the performance, but maybe even because of the business logic of your application. That was the point here. When you declare your transaction is read-only, persistent context also doesn't create entity snapshot and also ignore dirty checking. It helps to improve performance and memory efficient as well. It's a very long discussion here, and it really depends on what we actually use. Because if you are referring to, for example, and again, this is an architectural stream, which I shouldn't refer to a specific platform or another. But if you refer to, for example, how Hibernate, which is a Java framework that abstracts the persistency, works, then indeed, when you use the read-only transaction, there are a lot of things that don't happen behind the scenes in Hibernate. And that improves the performance as well. So that only one of the things is the fact that it's ignoring dirty checking. There are some more things that might happen there behind the scenes, and at some point I debugged on that code, and I don't know by heart to not tell you, and it's not the purpose of this stream to tell you what's behind such a framework. But the idea is that yes, you are right. So a good idea that I maybe didn't say, and maybe that's what you want to tell me that I should say, is that sometimes we like to mark our transactions as read-only just to improve the performance. I now said it, and I hope that's what you wanted to erase for me. And I think the time is up, and we managed again at least to go through the fundamentals, or at least through what I consider to be the fundamentals on this subject. And it didn't take us short, you see, it took us actually a lot of time to discuss it, 1 hour. But you now know a lot of things about what you need to take into consideration when discussing the consistency transactions and distributed transactions, and I hope that will really help you make your applications better in terms of either making them more performant, taking the right decision, as I've said, considering the business implementation, or simply keeping your data consistent. In the next episode, we will start focusing on another software quality, probably my favorite one, which is security. So up to that point, of course, I'm always looking forward for your questions. Thank you very much, everyone, for the participation and for your discussion. It's really nice to see how many people are here and discussing the chat. Don't forget that you can find me also on Twitter and LinkedIn, and have an excellent time for study further. Cheers.